Well, good morning to you. Thanks for joining me again on the News and Current Affairs program, The Ultimate Show, Politics Today, that comes live simultaneously on independent television and radio. I'm the host. My name is Philip Omo-Gupo. We'll be looking at a couple of issues, which the first will be on securing Nigeria, the task before Buhari. There has been a thread of issues, so much on how to secure the country. We have been having issues of banditry, terrorism, and how to really bring this to a lasting point where we can say we are out of the woods concerning fighting insurgents, banditry, kidnappers, and such like. Is basically the focus on today's discussion. And again, we'll be looking at the arrival of the COVID-19 vaccine to Nigeria and the formal rollout plan by the federal government. Yes, you recall that on Tuesday, the COVAX facility deployed some doses, almost 4 million doses to Nigeria. And it's expedient that we also look at ways in which the federal government will be embarking on that. We have the first to really be inoculated in that direction, and he is gone into history, as in the canon of history. The name has been written in gold, and he will be remembered for that. Dr. Cyprian Ngan happens to be the first to be inoculated in Nigeria. And we expect that the president and the vice will be receiving a job on that today. And so this is just to boost confidence on Nigerians on the need for them to also participate in ensuring that they receive the jobs or they are inoculated in this direction. Discussing the sensitive issues with me, starting from my immediate left, I have a security expert. One who is a custodian in that direction. He is also a clergyman, Reverend Sheriff Azeke. Thanks for coming, Reverend Sheriff.
Good morning and happy viewing beauties.
And next to him is another clergyman, articulate and erudite. He is the senior pastor of Sword of Liberation Bible Church, and he is Bishop Austin Igbasan. Thanks for coming, Bishop Austin.
Thank you for having me. Good morning, viewers.
And of course, next I have the convener of the concerned citizens of Edo, or rather convener of concerned Edo citizens, and he's also the voice of the commoners, as he usually calls himself. And of course, he's a political analyst, Roy Oribabo. Thanks for coming, Roy.
Yeah, thank you for having me. It's a concerned Edo Citizens Forum.
Okay, yeah. It's quite a long time now having you on set.
We have been busy, you know. Mobilize the commoners for a better society.
All right, big thanks for being part of this.
Thank you.
Well, as usual, we expect that as the show progresses, listeners on independent radio will be calling us. And of course, we will be voicing out the numbers that you'll be using, all right, to call us and ensure that you are civil. We always emphasize this, to be civil in your presentation, irrespective of the fact that your opinion is your opinion and not that of independent television and radio. But it's expected that you are civil. And for the viewers on independent television, the numbers will be placed on the screen as the show progresses for you to also participate. And it's all about you. It's all about helping to shape policies. It's all about helping to get a viral government that comes from you in order to deliver on the dividends of good governance. We usually don't say much about dividends of democracy anymore, but the aspect of good governance. But well, let me start with you. Let me start with you, Roy Oribabo. Now, we've been having issues about insecurity. The challenge of insecurity taking a huge bite on Nigeria. And just recently, the Northeast governors have been urging the federal government to hire mercenaries in order to tackle insecurity, though some experts and ex-military chiefs are against that option. What do you think about that?
I think personally, this is not the first time Nigeria government will be using mercenaries in the struggle against insecurity. Therefore, anything, any approach that will serve as a panacea to the insecurity that have bedeviled this nation, yes, sincerely, we endorse it. I will support it. I will mobilize for it. As the voice of the commoner, the persons who are directly involved in this insecurity, people who have the major casualties are the commoners. Because the bourgeois are being protected. The bourgeois are protected. The commoners are not being protected. And that's the reason why some of us, we reject those, some of the persons who are resisting and rejecting the call of the call that they should not use machinery. Because these are bourgeois who are protected. They don't know the pay. People can no longer access their farm now. No. People can no longer go to market. You cannot travel freely on the way. But because those bourgeois are being protected by the taxpayers' money, that's the reason why they are saying they don't need it. And you also agree with me that some of them are also making profit out of the process. Why are you, and things that are supposed to serve as a solution, the problem that is confronting this nation, persons are saying they don't need it. This is not, Nigeria is not the only country in the world that have made use, who have subscribed to the principle of machineries. Across the globe. Therefore, Nigeria will not be an exception. And I salute the courage of Mr. President. This is the first time for a very long time I will be appreciating Mr. President. I'm not his fan. And I'm not being sure I was his one. We get to a time where I have to quickly disassociate myself with him. This is the first time for a very long time. That statement credited to him that any person will take care for the seven, shoot aside. It's one of the decisions he have taken that I believe. I wish the president was very hard by way of approach. Even his body language reflect that anybody, if there was a directive before that, anybody with certain ammunition, AK-47, need to secure, give them a directive that they should shoot aside. I wish there was such an instruction before. We could have no metamorphosis on this level we find ourselves now. Mm. To me, that is a welcome development. Okay. The security should take it as a point of patriotism, as a point of responsibility to act accordingly. Because any attempt, AK-47 is without it, I don't know the attempt to qualify it. It's a machinery that once you have it, it can pierce through four persons at the same time. Mm-hmm. Only one bullet can pierce through four persons. That will tell you the sophistication that is associated with that kind of a gun. For the president to come out very strong now, to say anybody, irrespective of the tribe, irrespective of the religion, irrespective of the class, and once you have been found with this AK-47, shoot aside. That's a commendable. And all of us need to stand around Mr. President. That is not just going to be a statement of policy, but they have to, and therefore a deliberate effort will be there to achieve this. One, the security apparatus of this country must act. They must take the responsibility that you don't need to be an Igbo man with AK-47, they will say, oh, you are an AK man, you will go. And Nigeria Obama will take AK-47 should be penalized.
Okay.
You know, now they should be able to look at this to do that. What are the points that will help us in this situation we find ourselves?
Okay, you raised a vital point concerning the AK-47.
Yes.
The statement credited to the president.
Yes.
But again, are you also looking at the sophistication in terms of weaponry that these security operators would have to face such persons holding such arms?
Of course, before the presidency, and the president will be giving us such direct instruction. He has also mobilized the leadership, I think very just on the leadership of the security attitude of those who are managing the security of this country at the highest level. He had a meeting
with the service chiefs.
Yes, he had a meeting with them, and he gave them a marching order.
Yeah.
He gave them a direct. Therefore, they are also, the onus is on them to also let the president know that we don't have the resources in terms of the machinery to also tackle this. That they did not say.
Or we don't have the adequate weapon.
Or the weapon. To me, since they have not been able to come out with that kind of statement that they don't have the adequate weapon, therefore, let us not be more Catholic than the Pope.
Okay.
They have what it takes to do that. And they should face us, face that immediately.
I'll come back to you. Bishop Austin, we have this issue where he said the use of mercenaries is a welcome development if the federal government would buy into that. But there are some who also believe that the use of mercenaries by countries to fight a war against insurgents, history has always have it that they've never won this war. And so it means there seems to be a foiling of the appetite of some of these mercenaries to continue in the fight in order for them to continue getting money. Don't you think if that is deployed, that could bring political issues where mercenaries will now also participate in the plunder?
You also believe that even the advent of the Boko Haram we are talking about today is also hired by some persons. The issue of Boko Haram is an open secret that is known to people. The people that brought them in for their own powerful reason, who were not able to feed the lion when the lion has now grown. So the issue of machinery, people both directly from government and from individual or power broker or power block or the people you call mafia. We know the mafia in this country who eventually brought the issue of Boko Haram for their own reason, who were not able to cater for them when the matter has skyrocketed or they have gotten to the place of power. And when they have rejected the same people they brought on board. So that issue of Boko Haram is an open secret. And there is no sincerity in the side of the government to fight it. Now, if the government is sincere, I give you some example. If you want to fight this war, in the days of Jonathan, machineries were brought in. It is this same government that sent them back. Those machineries were used before the election in 2015 to be able to recover some few local government. And I take you back to the time of General Kenneth Minima. The issue of Boko Haram was taken to 85% victory. Ask any of the soldiers that fought in Sambisa or in Borno, they will tell you that in the days of Kenneth Minima, 85% of this battle was won before Kenneth was removed. So the sincerity from the area of government, because don't forget that there are people that are merchandise, that this war is their own testimony. It is their own bread and butter. And they never do everything to make sure it is fair. Now, what do you need machinery to do? When you are overpowered for a reason, some persons are trained to fight in desert. Don't forget that this war is a guerrilla war, that it's not like a normal civil war. Where you say, okay, where our targets are. And for the government themselves, what stop our government by deploying drone? Not always asking of shooting AK-47. Thank God that the president said it, but our president did not come and tell us. We expected a broadcast. If the president is going to do that kind of a thing, it should be a broadcast. Not that the president said, when they were campaigning, it was not PA that was talking. It was not Chief Press Secretary that was addressing Nigeria. When they were campaigning, they came on board and stood on top of the platform to say, I will do this, I will do that. That kind of sensitive statement that is needed now. Don't forget that most people believe that the body language of Mr. President has given rise to some of these things that we have seen. I take you back to 2002, when this war that you saw in Iganta and Ibarapa, it happened in the days of late Lam Adesina. And the president went there as an ordinary man to say, why are you killing my people? When women are being raped and killed. So I take your mind back that those things we are seeing today were product of hope. Look at what Miyeti Allah has said in this country. Okay. Statement that have been made in Benue State.
But I don't have the right panelists. So if you are going to make a statement credited to associations, I don't have their representatives to tackle
it. It is also that we should. Let's go. We don't have their representatives. Let's go. It is on Bobo. Governor Tom is alive. All of us were here when Benue House of Assembly passed a law. People that were appointed to guide their people. And some set of people came up and said, and they looked at a sitting governor and said, go and die. This is what we are going to do. And nobody was arrested. We saw people that 77 people were killed. How many people in presidency visited? We had even including priests. So what we are talking about is that coming out to say anybody that carry AK-47, I cannot do Thanksgiving over it. Because one, I expected a sitting president who owes responsibility to protect life and property to make a broadcast that people should hear. You know what it takes to hear a president make declaration. Now for somebody to come and say, as citizens have said, it is in this government that I know that president is different from presidency. The citizens have said, this one has said, this one has said, pardon, that people tell what I said, everybody will take it for seven. Now, the question is that we have voted the president to see and say, I just saw so who saw the constitution of Nigeria, here I take and come back. Even though it's my junior brother that are carrying this, let this be done. That we hear our president say it, you hear from Islam, we don't let it was said. And considering the sensitivity of life and property that have been destroyed, and even these people are talking about our Islam, they rated a working list as my former three terrorists in the world. Yet, have our country put on them. You say anybody going to yourself, okay, but you call them to just raise it to have money. Now, what have you done? How many hours does it take this to protect IBOB? How many hours does it take?
Why do you have to tell your government has a challenge that? Because a faceless group you can't prescribe.
Oh, Boko Haram, and we get just a complete affair commission. As Boko Haram, the CSCP, as a big, you see, it is what you tell them to say, come your waste, never fire when you don't burn. But you must not be waste. Say that the public party will take face fire. But you don't talk and say, come your waste, never fire. It's not a little bit. We knew what is happening. Now, that's what to say, go and do this one. What do you tell people? I did a research recently and discovered that some of the bandits now are children of people that they appear to were murdered. Who fear the government has not protected their parents. And they fear that this is a way to defend the death of their parents that were murdered of the negligence of government. So what I'm saying is that if anybody carry away for children, we shoot them. We have not heard the president say it. I cannot do Thanksgiving over that one. I expected that with the number of lives that have been lost, Mr. President ought to have sat down and granted a broadcast as big as a general, as a leader.
But let's look at this. Even if he makes the broadcast and there is no action or facility to back that broadcast up, when they amount to something
else. The question is that, why is it not better? Is it not better that
he makes a statement and at the end he's
did you vote for the service chief? You still have the floor,
Bishop. When the service chiefs were decorated by the president, he did say that he's giving them weeks to ensure that they free the country from this insecurity situation. Basically, when a lot of farmers and the people have been taken away from their lands, they've run away from their land, so there should be a need for the service chiefs to boost the confidence of these people so that they will turn back and cultivate their lands for farm produce. So is that not an action by the presidency to make sure that this works by giving them an ultimatum in that direction?
Mr. Philip, on this same platform, president has told the former service chief that your best is not good enough. And I said it here. I said, when a man's best is not good enough, the man will do his worst. After that statement, what followed? Is it today that the president has been giving a statement? Now, after that statement, what happened? The same president who said their best is not enough, the people have to resign. Not that he sacked them, they resign. And when to compensate them, he gave their ambassadorial position. That is the same president. Then another thing that happened is that one of the chief of army staff even stood before National Assembly and said in 20 years that we are still going to be battling it.
And that it will take 20 years to tackle it.
What is tackle and battling?
That is the end of 20 years to be tackled. That's his opinion. I think you have to take action on that to make it less. The opinion of a man
who you are sending to be our ambassador, and the only way it can be interviewed in National Assembly is that this battle is still going to be in 20 years. And while he was there, he said, we are winning the battle, we have taken over. Now we are compensating him for negligence that have led many people to become orphans and widows. Yet another set of people you put there now, you said they should conquer them in weeks.
But is it not notable that he brought the sincere truth to bear?
Why did he not say that while he was chief of army staff? Why did he have to tell us that this battle is a 20-year battle to be won after he has left? And even at the end of receiving another trophy for fighting a 20-year battle and telling us it will end in 1 week. Where is the sincerity of the former chief of army staff? When you are telling us we are winning the battle, only when you are out now to take another trophy, you said it will take 20 years. Others are decorated now to win the battle, you said 20 years in 1 week.
I'll come back to you. Just like what you said, Sheriff Azeke, again, the new service chiefs also said this in this direction, looking at the defense chief of defense staff, Frank Rabo. Lucky Rabo, he said that there is this space of 100 days in office that would be used to really fight insurgency to a huge extent, where huge results will be coming out from that. Again, we are hearing such laudable statements. But you are a security expert. If we analyze the statements as made by Brutai when he was a chief of army staff, and then the statement he made after retiring from that, and then the statement that Frank, that Lucky Rabo is also making now. Do you see any disparity in the sincerity of our leaders, even in the military, to fight this to a standstill?
Before we go to that, we all know that the major work or job of the government is to protect the lives of citizens. But a government that cannot protect the life of its citizens has failed. And when a government fails, what do you expect people to do? When you see people reacting, when we are talking about security, you see people, tension is high. It's because lives are involved. If we are talking about the economy, I don't believe my bishop here will be reacting the way he's reacting. Because lives are involved. And the government is not really taking this issue of security serious. My pain now is that we have a government who is not sincere in army security matter.
You can't say the government is not sincere, because it's one thing for you to say that, but it's another for you to really base it, your argument, on facts.
Because the facts before us,
just like what Roy Rivabo said concerning the statement credited to the president, that anyone found holding AK-47 should be shot. Is that not a sincere statement?
You can see instability in the statement of our government today when it comes to security. It's like pursuing the shadow and leaving the shadow. Nigerians are becoming more confused. Nigerians are becoming more confused in the area of managing security in this country. Because when you are telling me one thing and I'm seeing a different thing, you make me more confused. And again, life that is so sacrosanct in Nigeria, life is no longer sacrosanct.
But you can't make a bogus statement that Nigerians are, because you can't say that. You don't have the statistics all Nigerians are.
Most
you are talking about some.
If you do analysis study, just go to the streets. It's not studio work. Go to the streets and do a research on how Nigerians are feeling when it comes to security.
Okay, how should the service chiefs, the new service chiefs, like the question I asked, how should the new service chiefs make a difference? Because it's one thing to give hope to Nigerians. It's another, like what the former Army Chief of Staff, Boretai, did say. It's another, after leaving office, you give another stretch of time. What is happening? How should they make a difference?
I think that statement of Boretai is so discouraging. You were there, you could not make much impact. Leaving, you are telling us that this thing is going to take 20 years. Too many Nigerians, when we heard that statement, it was perplexing. It was not encouraging at all.
Okay, in your own opinion, how long is it going to take? As a security expert.
If you want me to say...
Or you have not analyzed it?
No. If the government is sincere, if there is sincerity in operating or managing security issue in Nigeria, okay, it won't take long. It won't take long. I said it here that day. It won't take more than 1 month.
Are you serious?
To handle Boko Haram, it won't take more than 1 month. My brother,
they are rooted. Don't forget that.
I'm coming.
They are rooted and they are not sponsored.
They cannot be bigger than the government.
So how do you address the foreign bodies that are sponsoring them?
That's where the
former chief of staff did say this. Because it's one thing to take care of the roots. No, it's one thing to take off the one we are seeing here in the country. How do you tackle the one that is at the root?
You cannot be bigger than the government. If the government want to be sincere and they want to really face it squarely, my brother, 1 month, ask the military, these soldiers, just go and meet them one-on-one and ask them, what will it take you to finish this matter? They will sincerely tell you that this is not a big deal for them. They are so trained, they have everything it takes to finish this thing in less than 1 month. If there's a political will and the go-ahead is there, because if that pays the piper, details the tune. The president yesterday said he's giving them a few weeks to finish this issue of insurgency and
the security
issue. The question is, you are giving them a few weeks. What have you put on ground? Are you going to give them the full power to do whatever they want to do? But I love what the president said yesterday. He said, you are going to choose people on your own. Okay. We're talking about mercenaries.
Okay.
You're going to choose people on your own, not based on qualification, that's academic qualification, not based on rank,
but
based on competency.
Okay.
When we come out from this idea of tribalism, come out from this idea of using rank or certificate to handle security matter, we miss it.
So the president is making a progress in that direction.
That's why I said, I love what he said. If what he said is genuine, if tomorrow you will not, if tomorrow,
there is a condition.
Because if it's one thing to say something in the public, to manage it in the secret. If what he said is genuine, he will give them free hand to push whatever they want to push to solve this problem. I'm telling you, 1 month, Nigerians, 1 month is too much.
How do we address
to handle this issue?
How do we address the fifth columnist that is really taking us backward? Because the military, the Nigerian military, will want to really embark on this headlong, but the fifth columnist seem to slow them down.
That's why I say sincerity is very, very important. Very, very, if we are sincere with what we are doing, when you remove sincerity from security, you will get obscurity. There will be much confusion, and the people will be more confused. Let us call spade a spade. Whoever is guilty of whatever that is hindering this security issue not to be solved should be dealt with squarely. No matter who you are, whether you are in the high place or whatever, if your hands are not clean, if you are the one
dragging the whole thing backward in the airspace of whatsoever. Such person should be dealt with.
Okay. What are your emergency role available for the president in terms of the service chiefs in fighting insurgency?
Well, to me, you know, president is a unit of presidency. You know, when the constitution envisages a situation and declare that the security and welfare of the people is a direct responsibility of the government. Well, they are saying it is no one person that make up government. We must get it straight. The services you are talking about, they are also part of the system. They are part of the government. They have a responsibility, irrespective of the fact that we did not, they are not political appointee. We did not vote for them in terms of election.
Okay, but tackling it in a few weeks, like the president said, is it workable?
Why is it not workable? There are theories to this belief. A former leader once said that for insurgency to last for more than 24 hours, that the government is involved. These are theories of facts. What does it take them to fight this? When we are talking about sincerity of purpose.
Okay, so
we are talking about determination. Against all the investment we might be investing in fighting against crime and criminality, once there is no sincerity, we will not go far. And when the president said to me, we should be able to give me a result, my brother, take your mind back. In this country, there is a Nigerian who is in Dubai, was sentenced in Dubai for sponsoring and financing terrorism in Nigeria. Are you not aware? The records are there. Far away Dubai, the person, as we are talking, is in gay. Nigerian government, have we been able to look at it and say, wow, look at the source. How Boko Haram, are they getting their finance? Who is financing them? What is their source of revenue? How are they feeding? Have you been able to track that? You saw the effort the CBA put that after the SRs, looking at the bonds of papers, how they were not looking at that, monitoring what it's like. To the SRs, you can see how we have reduced our government and government too. Instead of the CBA to be more bothered about those who are financing the terrorism.
Okay.
Those who are empowering the terrorism, the bandits, the Boko Haram. If they don't have resources, they will not be able to declare war on Nigeria.
So searchlight should be on that.
That is what we are talking about. The Nigerian government must be very determined, and they must demonstrate a level of sincerity. Well, there must be a level as well. Let us monitor how are we fighting this. Are we forcing war in this country? I remember our Minister of Finance went to say, how do we want civil war? He said, the federal government, let us look at the source of financing. Let us look at what they are eating. Let us see how are they getting TV. He said, by that we broke this way. After the government embarked on that, what happened to the war? It was a win-win situation for the devil. What we expect, that's the reason why we continue to hammer a talk of this. The real issue is sincerity. The Nigerian government have not been able to demonstrate that. They have not been able to show that. Once you show that, what is dealing with? Mm-hmm. What is dealing with is too much. By telling those men who the Boko Haram, the kidnappers, the bandits who are in the forest now, there is no sense that show that the man who have not eaten for one week will be and we have strength to fight. Once you won't take a meal for 1 week, my brother, your body will go down. Your level of energy will reduce drastically. Therefore, if government can look at how they're getting their source of feeding, you don't need the rocket science to fight this war. Government sincerity, take it and look at it. By the time we are able to get the source of feeding, if you lose it, then who is Boko Haram again? A hungry man will collapse on it. Those in the forest will collapse. What are they going to be doing when they are not eating? Now, the bandits, they are not only kidnapping, they kidnap at demand for ransom. And now we are now in a system where government is even negotiating to go and pay. Mm-hmm. You are giving them incentive. You are giving them a sense of belonging. You are endorsing their illegality. By the time you are paying ransom, you are endorsing their illegality. You don't expect them to go down. That is a primary source of their funding. That is a primary for of their sources. By the time they pick 200 something from school, you go and give them a few millions in dollars. You are telling me that the people will go there and tell you, it's not possible. Because that money they are going to invest in. What are they investing in? They are buying more arms. They are buying more arms. And the Nigerian government should be able to take the level. Look at our diplomatic relationship. What are we doing with those? We should be able to trace to where those arms are coming, arms and munitions. Where are they coming? I'm aware, you are aware, that the Boko Haram does not have a manufacturing factory inside the forest that they are getting those ammunition for. What does the Nigerian government need to do? Trace the source of those who are producing and manufacturing those arms and ammunition for them. By the time you have that kind of issue, then you now look, this country, why are you doing this like this? There must be a diplomatic resolution.
That will be a you've raised a very vital point.
On the short of that, yes. we should be looking at 3 weeks, my brother. What is 3 weeks?
Thank you, Roy.
Other 1 week, my brother, we should be able. Let government demonstrate sincerity.
Thank you, Roy, for that wonderful articulation. Well, let's go to the basis, because some experts are saying that for the war against Boko Haram to be won successfully, the government needs to go back to the drawing board, go back to the root cause of the Boko Haram upspring. You agree with me as a clergyman that there's been this religious violence, you know, in the country between the country's Muslims and Christians in the past. Which is one of the issues that has been raised? Then the aspect of the Boko Haram sect aiming to Islamize the country. What sensible steps should the government take in order to avert this?
One of the steps the government ought to take is to also practice it that the country is not a Muslim country or a Christian country, that is a secular nation, which the government themselves have not demonstrated, especially the government of President Muhammadu Buhari. If I give you statistic of all the security apparatus today, apart from Lucky Irabo, Lucky is also an island that is a Muslim.
It's not a Muslim.
The wife is from Katsina, and the rest of them. Now, I think the chief of air staff, because I got a report that this thing in Agbo was the one that built it and all the rest. No,
okay, but
I'm just trying to point some torchlight. You know that service chief are political appointees. Say you know that they are not military appointees. They are political appointees.
Yeah,
you cannot just wake up in the morning and say, I'm a security service chief. they must have been able to see that your interest is connected. You have a kind of connection with commander-in-chief. So it's not something that is done by merit. It's done by merit. It's done by the dispersion. That is the constitution of Nigeria, where it's zeroed down. Okay. So if a president decides to see a black man, he can say, come and be this one. It's the discretion. That is how the constitution put the lacuna to make the president to have power to do something. So when you look at the appointment of Mr. President, in the security apparatus we are talking about today, how many Muslims are there? How many Christians are there? We are talking about religious tolerance and how you can bring people together. I'll give you an example that even during Obasanjo's time, when Obasanjo saw that security expert, because there is rivalry, one of the reasons why the war cannot be ended easily is that there is rivalry, there is no synergy between the security apparatus.
Okay.
I give you an example that there are two Muslims among the service chief who doesn't pay the same mosque. This service chief that were retired, that they don't even see eyeball to eyeball, they don't pay the same mosque.
So that disparity is a challenge.
That one alone, one controls an aeroplane, the other one controls the foot soldiers on the ground. You needed the people up to help you do some bombardment and for the man on ground to order some people to do a mop up. And these two persons are the same religion, yet they don't see eyeball to eyeball, and they don't pray in the same mosque. So the issue
they mustn't pray in the same mosque.
No, leave that one. When people like us are talking now, you know that we are not just talking fables.
Oh, okay.
Do we need prayer to fast?
So what I'm saying is that if you make me now head of immigration, and you make the man of God head of custom, and two of us are not friendly, and we want to tackle the border for people coming in.
Okay.
Me on my own, I'm going to open the border as an immigration head to say everybody enter. Now, what are the things we are talking? Is this not our same government that opened the border and make our border visa free? So you want to protect your country, you make it visa free for everybody to come around, and you say you are fighting insecurity. You see, this is our government. Let me not use that word disorganized, but let me use the word that uncoordinated. That is why you see that we say, COVID-19 day, but go and do your NIN and gather there and pack yourself like Bashadin. But there is transmission where people are gathered, but go and do your NIN. The NIN must be done within 48 hours. Same government, he said, fight COVID.
Yes, I think the government is trying to say that it should be organized physical distancing. That doesn't stop.
I will look at Ikeja.
I think it's the one in my
government.
Continue.
that is why we are president. I can tell you what our people gather like sardine. Hey, we are fighting COVID. It's a social distance. Why we go to airport? Should you see in the airport? Social distance. Don't touch this one. Smile. Watch your back. But when we get inside aircraft, you can laugh somebody.
Nah, really?
Go ahead. See, I'm not telling you what I say. You can laugh somebody. I'm not telling you. I asked them. I said, where is the social distance? You now see hypocrisy. Now we stand social distance in the airport to illuminate your back, walk like this, don't touch person. When we get to aircraft, everybody back like Shadid. Look, look at international aircraft. You see, there's no social distance. No social distance. Inside the plane. Right. Here we all gather together and we can transmit it to one another. But here we are in an open air, maintain social distance. But when you involve the economy, back yourself, sit down there. It doesn't matter. Even if you transmit for all of yourself.
So all this thing boils down to sincerity of
purpose. Sincerity. Now I give you an example of the appointment of the security service chief. We have 26, 27. Only two Christians.
Okay.
Now you want to tell us that sitting president also is trying to bring.
Well, but we can't. We have not confirmed that statistics yet. When you say only two Christians,
if you want to confirm it, doing it by memory verse for you, I will be mentioning their name. I mentioned their name.
We'll do that in another edition.
That's what I'm telling you. If we are talking of religion now, that if a president come out, look at appointment, look at NPC. Count from 1 to 20. I count where they came from. Look at their religion. I know people who have falsified their age now to sit down back with this government, to sit down back. But they can't retirement.
Let me quickly correct him now. You know, the reason why Nigeria is not working, it is because we build our faith on religion.
If you say Nigeria is not working, that's your opinion.
No, it's my opinion.
So you can't say the reason why Nigeria is not working.
It's
not agreeing.
No, the reality of ground. The facts are there. Now he's talking about religion. He's talking about that you need to be a Christian. Instead of us to be talking about competency, he just celebrated. For me, he celebrated that a Benin president have just been appointed in the U.S.
Okay.
What are they looking for? They are looking for competency. They are looking for what will make it to work. As a country, I expect all of us to be looking for competence. This is only time for we to be talking
about religion.
My brother, in this country that does not have competent people.
No, I'm not. No, you hear me. You mentioned NPC just now. Yes. In this state, a Benin man, an Edo State man, was the number one man in NPC. Mm-hmm. During the process of period of recruitment, what did he do? Does that mean those of us who did not apply to be an NPC?
Okay, well, back to the. You have 1 minute to round off on that point.
Now, there is no tribe in Nigeria that does not have qualified people. If you are going to talk of security, every tribe has general. Every tribe have people that are tested and trusted.
And you are talking about religious tolerance.
Yes,
so that's tolerance.
When we are going to say, we know this country, we have diverse religion, we have tribes, and democracy is about sense of belonging.
There should be adequate representation.
Now, if you make an Igbo man to be head of social brigade, I tell you now, there are people fighting this Boko Haram war over 5 years in Borno.
Okay.
Why? Because they don't have somebody up there. Yeah. And they come from one part of Nigeria. Now, then look at that man that returned to Edeh Barak and killed the wife, and killed 4 children, and killed 4 other soldiers. Before they were able to hold him, he was almost killing each other. He returned, he was there for over 6 years. How do you put a man in the warfare for 6 years? Because he came from one part of Nigeria, because he belonged to one part of Nigeria, or belonged to one part of faith. Everybody should stay 1 year and a half.
You are developing a big
chance. Every tribe in Nigeria has competent people to be able to hold
him. In case you just join us, as politics today, and we're looking at securing Nigeria, the task before Buhari. And it's time for you to start pouring your calls at us. Don't forget to also join us via our social media platforms. And of course, you call us on the number 052-290-573. For our listeners on Independent Radio, let your calls start pouring in. 052-290-573. And of course, also to our distinguished viewers on Independent Television. Well, Sheriff Azeke, now, how do we tackle this issue of religious tolerance?
I think, like what he said, sincerity of purpose is very, very important. Because when you are making appointments, you should balance the equation. When the equation is not balanced, that is where there will be problem. The time you begin to put one religion into position in the expense of the other religion, you are calling for anarchy, and you are increasing insecurity. Mm. It's another way to increase insecurity. We are talking about fight against insecurity. There are some policies that the government will operate that will even increase insecurity. It will give birth to insecurity. So the government should be very careful with the kind of policy they enact or they put before the people. Because if care is not taken, it will increase insecurity.
Okay.
Very, very important.
Okay, thank you.
Another area I want to buttress before you go into the other side of it, I still say our borders. With whatever we are doing as internal security, if our borders are not taken care of, I said it the other day, if you build a good house without good fence, you have exposed that house to danger. That house is porous to anything. No matter the investment we put into security when it comes to internal security, and our borders are not taken care of.
Okay, thank you, Sheriff Azeke. Well, it's quite awesome to know that you're with us, you're following us on the program Politics Today. But we're going to be taking a short break, and after that, we extend the frontiers of this discussion. Don't you go away.
Julie, I love the Lord Jesus passionately.
Why?
Because
He loves me. I cannot tell why.
Do you know He loves you too? Love made Him die on the cross for us. He resurrected and met with the disciples in Galilee. Let's commemorate this on Easter Monday.
Wow, great idea.
ITV Radio, in partnership with God's Forgiveness Deliverance Ministry, presents Galilee Experience 2021. Word ministration by Pastor Chris Ewazegbae Egbon, the spoken prophet, host, and general overseer, God Forgiveness Deliverance Ministry, Solution Headquarters, aka Just Like That.
Theme: Worthy is the Lamb that was slain.
Worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain.
Songs ministration.
Thank you so much for joining us again on the show Politics Today. Well, you recall that on Tuesday, the federal government received some doses, almost 4 million doses of the COVID-19 vaccine, AstraZeneca. And we are looking at this and the need for us to have a proper rollout plan for the vaccination of the Nigerian citizenry. Well, what do you make of this as we expect the calls to start pouring in? What do you make of this development, Roy Olivabo?
It is very direct, you know, from we from the concerned Edo cities for all within the week. We released a press statement calling on Nigerian government not to make this vaccine a VIP oriented. Because the way and manner they are going now is to appear this vaccine strictly for the bourgeois. And with the commoners, we are going to resist them. We will resist them because the machineries on ground, the foundation they have laid in the distribution and administration of this vaccine now is strictly for the bourgeois. Therefore, we the commoners will not be cut off for the arrangement. Government must take it back. We must take it back.
Wait. But I don't understand where you are talking from, because the aspect of deployment, it has been said that it will be given to states.
Yes.
And state government will ensure that they give the vaccination to the citizens.
Yes.
So where are you talking about?
Are you not aware that the website that be registered for you to, you have to go and register? Are you not aware?
Okay.
They say directly to that.
Okay. I'll back to you, but let's quickly take this call. Good morning, caller. Tell us your name, where you're calling from, and kickstart your contribution.
I'm David. I'm calling from Benin.
Okay, David, good morning. What do you have to say on this?
Okay. Good morning. You know, fighting a war is just all about numbers. You understand? We have to reduce their numbers to the barest minimum. These Boko Haram boys or bandits. When you reduce their number, don't tell us you are winning the war. You can repel people and they run away. Then you take over the territory that you are saying you are fighting the war, you are winning the war. Show us the dead bodies. We are ready to watch those dead bodies. we want to be counting them so that the enemies will know that, yes, you are really fighting, you are really winning the war. Now tell us that we've drove Boko Haram away, we've drove bandits away. Are you killing them or you are driving them away? Because these people, their numbers are increasing.
Okay, thank you, David. Thank you, David. We got your point.
So as for the vaccine,
yeah.
Let the bourgeois, let them take those vaccines first.
He said let the bourgeois take it first. Well, the bourgeois will follow the leaders because
I will not agree with that. I will not agree with that.
Thank you. Thank you very much, David. You don't agree with that.
My position is very dotted. That the federal government, they said they have set up a website that you have to go and register. And I'm asking them, how do people from Mohodoa access a website? There's a community that we don't have life for the past 10 years. How do people from Umbibe, how do they access a website? How do you access where there's no life, the phone is no network? You will see there's already a design, a direct design by those in position of authority, by the bourgeois, so make sure that they restrict it to their self. Okay. So further punish the commoners like us.
And you are speaking for the commoners.
Of course.
So that's why you have to make sure that your voice is heard.
Of course.
Nana, what's your viewpoint in this development, Austin Igbasa?
Concerning the, I have a different opinion.
Okay.
And there's a disconnection between the leaders and the led. How many of the poor people even want to take the vaccine now? How many people are ready to take
it? I'm ready.
Please, let's quickly take this call, Bishop Austin. Good morning, caller. Tell us your name, where you're calling from.
Good morning, our guest. Don't pass it up, please.
I'm Lagos man.
Yes, Oronsaye from Ekpeko Abbey.
Okay, Oronsaye, go ahead with your contribution.
Yes, it's a very big pity. The most that is said about this, our government of the day, from federal level, they are not listening to us. We have said so many things for them to know what is happening. They don't care. How can we fight Boko Haram for several years without an end? You see, as one of the guys said there, it cannot take more than 3 weeks to eliminate this insurgency in our country. You see, it's a question of the government giving our men the subjugated people, engage more to damage the workforce, and give water to those people that are already capturing the city. Give them food. I don't know how you can fight war without water, without food.
Okay. Okay, Lagos man, Oronsaye. Thank you. You've articulated your point in that direction. But what do you have to say concerning the arrival of the vaccine in Nigeria?
Vaccine is a total failure because many people have told that how do we know how to go to the website? Many people have told that how do they hear from the radio or television?
Thank you. Thank you, you made your point. Well, you heard what he said. All right. You heard what he said. Over to you. You have the floor.
Yes, I think the orientation, National Orientation Agency, I have not heard so much about them to really educate people. You know that there are people that still believe that there's no COVID-19 in Nigeria. There are people that have that belief, as we are talking now, that they believe that we don't it's not even in Nigeria.
Which is a disappointment.
Yes, because
also it's real.
Uh-huh, that is where the reality of town crier. We expected how to reach out to people in their locality and be able to tell them what is this thing called coronavirus.
Okay.
How to contact it, how to get out of it. Is it everybody that have television? Is it everybody that have radio? There are people that they are in their farm. Anything we are doing on television here, is it somebody that is struggling to sell pure water in the Ghost Loop that will hear what we are saying on air now?
Okay, why that is ongoing? What do you make concerning the statement that Roy made, that it seems that the vaccine is for the bourgeois?
It was designed like that.
Really?
You know, if you look at it, it's not from the grassroots. It's not going to be from the grassroots because look at, we say 4 million. are definitely the 4 million that we are talking about is meant for 2 million because you are going to take it twice. So if you are taking it twice, is that 4 million is going to be for 2 million?
No. It's not this one they are going to take twice.
Okay.
This is the first dose.
It's distributed
all around.
Okay. So the citizens to take the first 4 million.
Yes.
They are going to be having more money.
Less than
4 million.
Now, what the COVAX just brought is a welcome development. And it shows that we have been more. I believe that we have been But is it not a laudable development that means that we are the federal government was able to
pull strings to bring this vaccine?
I figured that you speak in this direction.
Now, where are our professor of virology and epidemiology? We expected them to be inside all night and be doing all night VG that government make money available. I'm not celebrating COVID that this thing that is coming for somewhere. Where are those men that are tested and trusted and academicians that are in this field? I expected the country to look at our local, what we can do locally that we can use to sort it out. Do you know what it takes to bring these things to Nigeria?
Okay, last time that is used.
We have on the call.
Hello, good morning, caller. Hello, good morning, caller. Tell us your name, where you're calling from. The Deputy Chief, Central Mosque. Thank you very much for taking our time to be part of this. Okay, well, you have the floor, Azeke.
I think everything still boils down to sincerity. Thank God the first batch of a vaccine has arrived. Mm. The issue, if you watch very well, we have been having tensions everywhere, whether security or whatever. Now, this vaccine is another direction to keep Nigeria busy again. We keep on talking about security, vaccine, coronavirus, this. We are busy with all these things without developing our country. It's to the expense of our development of our country. The vaccine that has already arrived, 3.9 million vaccines. I think the issue there is that if federal government will judiciously distribute these vaccines, orientation is very, very important. It's a key word. Because we have school of thought. We have different school of thought in Nigeria. There are a group of people that believe there is no coronavirus. Nothing you can tell them. I heard the governor of Kogi yesterday say he does not believe in it. And he even said it that he's not going to take it. That is here and healthy for a governor to come up that way to say he does not believe in it. And if you check the records, general record, last time I checked, Kogi asked 5.
Okay.
In the attendant. Then, all right. In terms of mobilization, sensitization, enlightenment, orienting the people on how this vaccine works is a sole duty of the government.
Thank you very much, Sharif Azeke, a security expert. And big thanks to you, Bishop Austin Igbasan, for taking our time Bishop Austin Egbasa, Senior Pastor, South of Liberation Bible Church. And we really appreciate you for, in spite of your busy schedule.
Yes.
All right. So big thanks again, Roy Oribabo, political analyst, and thank you for taking our time.
Thank you for having
this,
me.
As the voice of the commoner.
Thank you.
Well, big thanks again to our listeners on Independent Radio and viewers on Independent Television. We'll do this again same time next week. And also, big thanks to the callers. Big thanks to Lagos Man, Ronsai. Big thanks to David and all those who made attempt to call, but we couldn't take the calls. Well, I'm Philip Omo Gupon. We'll see you on the next one. Goodbye.